Well, I'm so excited. Today is the day. It is finally the day we've been waiting for the past couple of weeks. You guys have been faithful. You guys have been buying lots of craft dinner. And I'm so excited to see what the final number is going to be. I don't know what it is, but I know that you guys will have shown to have come through. That's my prediction. My prediction right now is that we would have blown past our target. I'm sure we have. I just don't know what we're going to end up with. But I know that we're going to take it. We're going to pack it. We've got some volunteers there coming to the church to meet us there. And we're going to take this stuff up, pack it into a car, and just go over and meet our friends over at the Salvation Army Church and unload it on them and hopefully get a little tour and see what they're up to. So I'll catch you in a little bit. We'll see you at the church. Wow, 1,126 boxes. Excellent job, Verity. Great work. And a bunch of people here at the church to help us out. Just a big shout out to Ken, to Al, to Judy and Bailey, Rebecca and Haley and Dusty and myself. We're just here just loading up the Elantra. And I know everyone's been wondering, the biggest question on everybody's mind is exactly how many boxes of craft dinner can fit into the back of an Elantra. Well, we're about to find that out, guys. It's time for us to do something.
Talking about how we are God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be. Live like angels of apathy who tell ourselves it's all right, somebody else will do something.
Church, we are here at the Salvation Army. We're about to give about 1,126 boxes of craft dinner. You guys came through big time. My heart is full. I am so proud of all of the generosity you guys showed and giving these massive amounts of craft dinner. So they could use it. They're excited to see us, and we're excited to be here and bless them with it today.
Well, here we are today receiving over 1,000 boxes of craft dinner. We're just stunned at the generosity of Verity Church partnering with us as we serve the COVID-19 emergency hampers here at the Salvation Army Community and Family Services. We love Kitchener. We love Verity Church. We're so excited. And yeah, just thank you so much. Woohoo!
Good morning! If you don't know me, my name is Melody, and I'm really excited that you're able to join me for Verity Church Online. If this is your first time checking us out, I'm glad you're here. We look forward to spending the next hour worshiping with you, and if you haven't seen our Facebook page, please check that out. We'd love to get to know you, so drop us a message. Just a reminder, to join us in the foyer at 11:30 for our Zoom meeting. Today we are grilling, getting to know our new associate pastor, Nathan, and his wife, Justine. If you didn't get your link to this meeting, please email info@veritychurch.com before 11:30. Let's ask God to bless our time together. Please join with me in prayer as we prepare for the service to begin. Lord Jesus, we are thankful that you are among us today. Unless your spirit is among us today, our gathering is in vain. Please lead us and guide us as we worship with you in our activities here today. We thank you for your goodness and gracious.
Well, it's time to lift our voices in worship. So we just ask if you join us, sing loud. We just want to lift the name of the Lord on high this morning. So speak about God's grace and how it is sufficient for us. Here we go. Faithfulness, oh God. Well, I think most of us are going to know this next song. So let's sing this out together. Here we go. 2, 3, 4. Awesome. well, from such rich traditional lyrics to just a simple thought that Christ has bought us, and we're all bought with a price, the ultimate price, and he has freed us from the power of sin, from the power of darkness and death. And it's because of that we can sing that we are no longer slaves. Let's sing this together. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me.
Hey Verity, this is a church basement. This is Korean writing. This basement used to be filled up with lots of, what we're saying, junk. And I'll show you what to do. Come with me. This is life as a church volunteer here. today. Well, we're gonna take this outside to our little pile. There's still a ton of work that we need help with. So, you could sign up. You can get a hold of the office. And you know what? How about they throw the number up on the bottom of the screen? They wanted me to tell you the number, but you ever like call someplace or see it on the TV and it says, call this number. Well, let's have that down here. And I always find myself struggling to find a piece of paper to write things down. You know, when someone leaves you a voicemail and like, call us back at this number. I can never get the thing on time. I gotta listen to the whole message again. So if our lovely office folks have the number down here, it would be great if they could somehow line that up with my hand. It'd be fantastic. So lots of work to do. It's gotta be, I think, between 9 and 4. And we gotta comply with the government bylines. Government always ruin our fun. But we can only have, I think, like 5 people in the building at a time. So please, call us. We buy gold. Right here is water. So a big old jug of water. H2O. It's important. Make sure you get enough of it. What else is important is KD. Look at all that KD. So that's what we've got so far. I think the drive's over, but I just wanted to show it off because I know I added to it. I want to feel important. Also, we've got prayer meetings every Tuesday night that they're doing Zoom for. So please just contact Judy and they can get you set up for that. Okay, enjoy the service.
Well, good morning, Verity family. As we go to prayer this morning, we want to have the stance of the song we declare to Jesus, "How Great Thou Art." So as you bow your heads and you close your eyes and we pray together, let's remember, He's great, 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 great God. So let's pray. Lord, we are so grateful to You for who You are. You have done so much in our lives and in our faith community. We are so thankful for the things You've done, things seen, things unseen, things we haven't yet even comprehended. And You've done this in our lives. Thank You so much for that. Thank You for the opportunity and the joy of serving the Salvation Army in our craft dinner project. And we pray a great blessing on the Salvation Army as they serve in our community. And we pray for many more opportunities to partner with them to care for those around Verity Church. Thank You for that. We are thankful that You've answered so many prayers for us. And we just bow before You this morning with a heart full of gratitude and praise and worship to You. Thank You so much. We praise You today for Your good, and Your mercies endure forever. We pray for those today in our family and in our extended family, those in our community who have come down with the COVID virus. And Father, we realize how painful that can be physically. And so we pray that You would care for them. We pray for those that have cancer illnesses. And Jesus, we just pray that You would come beside them and walk with them, be with them, care for them mentally, physically, emotionally, socially. Give them peace to know that You are in the midst of their serious health issues. You're right beside them. And we pray that they would turn to You and know You in a very deep way. So we're grateful to You for that. Give them peace. And give them hope as they walk through difficult physical times. We pray for our international and cross-cultural workers in their places of ministry. We pray blessing upon them. We pray that You would give to them creative ways to serve their communities where they are. We pray for our elders, our team leaders, our volunteers, as we've been working at the Verity Church site, And thank you for that. I pray you'd continue to give to them stamina and health and vigor and strength as we prepare for the time when we can physically be together and worship you. Lord, we pray for our children and our youth, and we're thankful to you for them. We pray that you would draw them ever closer to you, that they would depend on the Spirit of Jesus in their faith journey, and that they would have a deeper love for your word, and you would so work in their lives that they would become men and women of faith and prayer and boldness and courage to stand for you in these dark times around the world. And Father, we do want to remember to pray for Ravi Zacharias' family. We lament that he is no longer with us here on earth. He went to be with you last week, and we rejoice with him that he's rejoicing with you. But Father, as his family no doubt is going through the gamut of physical and mental and grief, pain, I pray that you would surround them with your love, with your solace, with your care. Thank you. Scripture says, David said, even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we fear no evil. You are with us. So we pray for you would be with the Zacharias family. We pray for his daughter as she leads up the Ravi Zacharias International Ministries. I pray for her and her team that you would give to them boldness and courage and creativity as they minister in this day and age. And Lord, I pray that we as a community would continue to look to you, look at you, look for you, and help us, Father, to be men and women who do good. Teach us to be your faithful people. And help us to follow in your footsteps and be bold as we share Jesus with our neighbors. We give all of this to you, Father, again saying how great you are. And we say this in your very precious, powerful, wonderful name, Jesus. Amen.
Turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 5, verses 34 to 39. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, respected by all the people, stood up in the council and gave orders to put the men outside for a short time. And he said to them, "Men of Israel, take care what you propose to do with these men. For some time now, Thaddeus rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a group of about 400 men joined up with him. But he was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After this, Judas of Galilee rose up in the days of the census and drew away some people after him. He too perished, and all those who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I say to you, stay away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or action is of men, it will be overthrown. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them, or else you may even be found fighting against God."
Well, good morning. I am coming to you from the steps this morning of the Waterloo Region Courthouse. And this is a brand new building in the middle of our city. And it's kind of interesting because we've got like the courts, there's provincial courts, there's municipal courts, there are city buildings in the area, municipal buildings, and in fact, even federal buildings. And so we're kind of in the core of the city where all of these forms of government come together and interact with each other. And it wasn't like that in biblical days. In fact, religious and civil and layers of government were all kind of meshed together, kind of like they formed this mass, and it was sometimes hard to peel apart where one authority began and the other left off. And so for them, when they were in a courthouse, it had a religious context to it, national context, and even down to municipal, all kind of rolled into one. And so today in the surviving, moving from surviving to thriving series, we're looking at some challenges and some conflicts that were going on. In fact, you could even call this series Thriving Through Change, Thriving Through Conflict, Thriving Through Challenges. I mean, there's a preacher, they all started with C, but I mean, there are all kinds of circumstances in life that we need to thrive and in order to survive. And God knows that, and God knew that in the early church. And this morning, if you were to summarize it, it's wise counsel from Gamaliel is be careful how you respond to opposition. I mean, we can use that in our life in so many different ways. We have different forms of opposition. There's relational opposition. There's opposition at work. And even at times it feels like there's opposition even in the body of Christ. We know there shouldn't be. We know that's not the intention. But sometimes it feels like there's opposition all around us. And so many things today are tried not by fact and not by those who are qualified, but they're tried in the court of public opinion. And I don't know, sometimes I get tired of Facebook and Instagram and all of these things, because there are all kinds of opinions given in there, and it's like a person's motives are tried there, what they do is tried there. I can only imagine what it's like for people to be tried in the court of public opinion. And in fact, people today have an opinion on everything. In fact, you don't have to be an expert. You just have to have read enough articles on Google or Wikipedia, and all of a sudden, many people consider themselves an expert in all kinds of areas. And then they feel that they can give you advice. Do you find that? You go to do something and a person will say, well, here's how I would do it. And no, I wouldn't do it that way. I would do it this way. The people that really endear themselves to me are the ones who say, if that's not the way to do it, you need to do it the right way. And then they proceed to tell you what the right way is, as if they have the corner on the market of what's right. Some areas we can do that. Scripture is very clear and very plain, and we know what's right and we know what's wrong. But it comes down to those other areas of life. I don't think there is a right way to put the toilet paper on the hanger. Does it come down in front? Does it come from behind? As long as it does what it's supposed to do, that's really all that matters. And yet, I tell you, some people really take preferences to that outer limit, making their preference the right way to do something. And God knew his church was going to come under scrutiny. I don't know if you've felt scrutiny. Certainly as a pastor, I mean, that's something we live with. If you're in ministry in any degree to in a vocational sense, even as a volunteer, there are 10 people who can quarterback and armchair quarterback and tell you how you should have done it. But when you're out there doing it, sometimes things are not as easy as they seem. And God knew his church would come under that kind of scrutiny. And he gives us some insight on what it is like in the early church, is they come under intense scrutiny, not only in the public opinion polls, but in the government of that day, which was very religious, very, very much tied up civil and religious government together. which we don't really have that concept today. Ours is more separation from state, kind of based on the American context, than what the early church was. And so today is, we're in Acts chapter 5, and starting at verse 33, we see the response of the council. Remember last week, John and Peter had been thrown into prison. They got out of prison, did that prison break thing. Angel tells them, go and teach. So they go right to the temple. And they begin teaching in the name of Jesus. And the council was mystified where they were. Nobody could find them. And then all of a sudden it was like, hey, guys, the guys you put into jail, they're in the temple. And hey, guess what they're doing? They're teaching the very thing that you told them not to teach, in the very name you told them not to teach it in. And so they're hauled back again. And today we pick up the story in verse 33, and we see the response of the council. But when they heard this, I'm talking about the council here, that Peter and John were not going to obey them, that in fact they were accused of instigating Jesus' crucifixion. Not only were they teaching in Jesus' name, but they were pinning it right on the people who were the judges right now and saying, it's you guys. You guys are responsible for this. And so when they heard this, they were cut to the quick. When they took in what Peter and John were saying, they're cut to the quick. And yet, it's not something we use a lot today. That word is to be vexed. It means to be torn apart. The thing that it reminds me of is one time I was jumping off of a dock into the water, was coming up the ladder of the dock, and my foot slipped, and the edge of my big toenail caught on the wood as I was pushing down, and it peeled the toenail straight up and off of the nail bed, and I just picked it up like that and picked the whole nail. That's being cut to the quick, torn asunder, vexed, ripped apart, and intended. They had the mindset at this point to kill them. The only way we can deal with these guys is to kill them, get rid of them, do to them what we did to Jesus, and hopefully they won't be raised up from the dead. And then we see the Council of Gamaliel next, but a Pharisee. Now, Pharisees are different than Sadducees. The first to speak last week were Sadducees, the liberals that didn't believe in the resurrection, didn't believe in miracles. The Pharisees were actually, could have been very easily aligned with Jesus. In fact, theologically, they didn't have a long ways to go. It was that they were doing things different, that Jesus was not exactly the way that they thought Messiah would be. And so they were in this box, and that box had bound them, and the box had blinded their eyes to who Jesus really was. And so the Pharisees are the conservatives, and they are the, you know, as I was saying, they're the ones that were closest to what Jesus taught, and yet had this blindness. And so now Gamaliel is a Pharisee, and he is speaking to the council. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, he was a teacher of Torah. In fact, we find out later in Scripture that Gamaliel actually taught Paul. Before Paul came to Jesus, became a follower of Jesus, Paul was a student of Gamaliel. And Paul was a Pharisee, and he was trained by Gamaliel. It's like today, if in theology you were trained by N.T. Wright, and he became your personal friend, your personal mentor. He gave you advice. He trained you. He was your personal teacher in all things. And so that's kind of the relationship, it seems, that Paul had to Gamaliel. So this guy was, and who knows? I was talking to Nathan this week, and I said, like, do you think Paul tried to tell Gamaliel about Jesus after the fact, after the conversion? Like, what was the relationship like then? Was Gamaliel still open? Maybe he became a follower of Jesus. We don't know. But he's a teacher of the law, and it says kind of the credibility that he has, that respected. He was held in honor by all the people. And he stood up in the council, so that implies he's a member of this council, a member of the high court that we had talked about. And he gave orders to put the men outside for a short period of time. To give orders means it wasn't a suggestion, it was a command. So he had some authority in this group and enough respect that he could ask that kind of thing, and the people responded right away. And he put the men outside and removed them from the court. And Peter and John are now no longer there. Who knows how long this meeting had gone on? Maybe they were welcoming the respite. Maybe they were anxious, not knowing what was going on. Ever had a meeting about you that you weren't in? What's even worse is a meeting about you that you weren't in that you didn't know about. You get a sense of where these guys are at. And he said to them, to this council, the 71, take care that what you propose, what you have in mind to do with these men. And then he gives some examples of the past about some things that had happened with other men. And he lays out his argument for what he's about to recommend. And he talks about two men, Thutis. Actually, I thought it was Thaddeus, but it's actually Thutis. We learn about him from a Jewish historian named Josephus. For some time ago, Thutis rose up claiming to be somebody. He was making a name for himself. He was passing himself as somebody who was should be listened to. And a group of about 400 men joined up with him, but he was killed. Now, Josephus tells us what happened. The Romans got tired of him. They ambushed him, cut off his head, took it back to Jerusalem, and put it on display to kind of make a statement that they were not happy with someone who was rebelling. And all who followed him were dispersed. It means to be dissolved. Kind of think of salt in water or snow melting. Like they just went away. And they came to nothing. And then he has example two, a guy named Judas, verse 37. After this man, Judas of Galilee rose up in the days of the census. Not sure whether it's the first census, second census, around the time of Jesus' birth, anyway, and drew some people away after him. And he too perished. He actually told people not to pay their taxes to Rome. And if you paid your taxes, him and his guys would come in, burn your house down, and take your cattle or livestock, anything you had left. And so he would, I mean, he made a name for himself, those who followed him were scattered. The point is that Rome knew how to deal with agitators. Rome knew how to deal with people who were causing them trouble. And so here's Gamaliel's conclusion of the whole thing in 38. So in the present case, the men we're trying right now, the men that we have in court right now, those people of the way, those people of the truth, those who are following Jesus, I say to you, stay away from these men. Leave them alone. And let them alone. Don't hound them. Don't come after them. Because if this plan, this or action is of men, if the source is man-centered, they'll be overthrown. They'll dissolve. That's the same word that was used earlier, to dissolve. But if it is of God, you'll not be able to overthrow them. Well, just like the two men that he talked about that Rome overthrew. If it's a man thing, they'll be overthrown in their own right. If it's not a man thing, you're not going to overthrow them like these other guys. Or else, in case it's that, you may even be found fighting God. I mean, that's a really strong picture that he brings here. I mean, have you been fighting any losing battles in your life? Some things that actually may be God ordained. You don't think they're God ordained. You think actually the worst thing that could have happened to you. And tell you, from the council's point of view, Peter and John are the worst thing that could happen to them. witnesses of this resurrected Jesus that they would like to pretend was no longer on the scene and was no longer causing any problem. They wanted that problem to go away. But that's not what happened. And I'm wondering if you're against something right now that's God ordained. And I got thinking about, how do I know when to stop? How do I know when to quit pushing? How do I know when the thing in front of me is maybe something that I need to let go and let God continue in? And maybe it's from Him and not the thing that I really don't want. And I put some things down here. When to stop. Stop when you've done everything that you should do. When I say you should do, everything the Bible says you should be doing, you've done it. If it's opposition in your life, I mean, you've talked to the person, you've tried to negotiate, you've tried to come to a satisfactory conclusion, you are not talking about it to other people, everything the Bible says you should be doing, you've done it, you're doing it, you continue to do it, and that opposition doesn't seem to go away. Number two, when you've surrendered ownership of that thing to God. Sometimes it's something like a business, it's something like a home, and I don't know if you guys remember the early 80s, like a lot of people lost their homes, and I mean recently in the 2000s, 2008, but in the 80s, interest rates were going crazy. I remember paying 27% interest for a normal bank loan, secured bank loan. I mean, it was nuts. And so have I surrendered that over into God's hands. And I tell you, when you're in those kinds of situations and you're in over your head, there always comes a point where you have to say, God, you're in charge of this. You're in control of this. Thirdly, I've examined your motives. Why am I fighting against this? Why is this coming against me? Why am I finding myself pressing so hard for this thing? It can be very hard understanding your own motives in things. And so as you look at your motives, is this for my gain? Is that why I'm driving so hard? Is it for my reputation? Is it for the thing that I want out of this for my own satisfaction? Am I willing to give that up? Am I willing to let go of that? And fourthly, have I fasted and prayed to the point of surrender? So much of life is a surrender, letting go of my say, letting go of my desire, letting go of my plan. I tell you, as a guy, that's really hard. Some of us are planners. Some of us are more entrepreneurial and want to make things happen. And that can be very frustrating to the people around us. And it can be very frustrating to us when it seems that that opposition is pushing back. And sometimes we can even get in the mindset that I'm going to make it happen. And sometimes I wonder if God doesn't allow us to push through and those things to happen, and where that's not His best plan for us, but He allows us, just like sometimes our kids. Have you ever done that? Your kids pushing for, and finally say, fine, go ahead, try that out and see how that works. Sometimes I wonder if God doesn't do that with us. Well, they take the advice, it says, and you know, they sort of kind of take the advice. They do the one thing, but they do it in a very rough manner. They took His advice after calling the apostles in. They flogged them. He used to thrash them, flogging with sticks, kind of a baton thing, and they would just, I think of a willow stick about maybe the size of your finger, kind of like caning, maybe. They beat them anyway, and and ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus. Like, that's the third time. You have that saying, third time's a charm. Not so for these guys. And then they released them. And then what gets me is the response of the disciples. And they have every right to be upset. They have every right to be angry. They have every right to be frustrated, to be afraid, to be scared, to be questioning what's going on. I mean, if those things happen to us, prison and flogging and standing. I mean, I've been in this courthouse a few times, and even when it's not you, it's intimidating. Like, I've watched guys try to joke with the judge. You don't joke with the judge. Okay, that just doesn't. You just don't do that. Judges look down on it when you joke with them. And so here they are. They've gone through all this, and these next words are absolutely amazing. So they went their way from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they had been considered worthy to suffer shame for his name. In front of the highest court in the land. What they're saying here is that God deemed that they could handle the situation. And they gave thanks to God that he had let them go through that to show their worth. Wow. And every day in the temple, so in large groups and from house to house, in small groups, they kept right on teaching. Amazing. These guys, they keep on teaching and preaching. Preaching just means to proclaim something. They say, stop preaching at me. Well, stop proclaiming. Stop telling me is what you're saying when you're saying preach. Sometimes we think of preaching as this, you know, kind of like in the 50s when guys screamed at the top of their lungs and they were, you know, they'd get a sweat on and all red in the face, and you thought they were about ready to bust a blood vessel. That's not preaching. In our society, maybe we think it is. You know, I've heard people say that about, oh, I heard some good old-fashioned preaching. Well, I'm not sure that's exactly what the Bible would call preaching. It's proclaiming. It's telling the truth. It's doing it with compassion. It's doing it with a heart to see the person hear and listen and respond in a positive way. Not condemning, that's for sure. And they kept preaching, though, that Jesus was the Messiah, that he was the Christ. Sometimes I make rash decisions. Sometimes it's not really the decision I thought out very well. Especially like when I'm behind somebody and I'm driving and I'm waiting for, ever seen, like, you know, there's only so much light, and you get the person there who won't turn left even when there's a space big enough to drive a house through. You know, I've been known to tell that person that this is not a career decision they're making. This is simply turning left. And I can get really heated and upset and frustrated. It's amazing how many times God just speaks in a quiet voice in my heart about, well, do you remember when you did that? And do you remember when you cut that person off and you just didn't see them? Or remember that time you were sitting at the light thinking about something and the person honked their horn behind you and you were the guy holding up the whole show? I love it when God does that. It's good for you. It's good for me. Sometimes I just make commentary on people's things, and I give this advice to them, even if they're not present. And I have a dialogue with a person who's not there. that makes you look kind of silly if you're sitting in the car or and somebody's watching you, or you're walking down the street and you're having this conversation. I'd say probably you shouldn't do that. That's not a good thing to do. With this COVID thing, I found it extremely frustrating. I have found it very easy to pass judgment on stores and clerks, and we've got a Tim Hortons near us, and I think this must be under new ownership, and it's like nobody there knows how to run a Tim Hortons, and I think one out of every three orders I've gotten lately has been wrong. I know I've had black coffee, I've had coffee with sugar and no cream, I've had coffee with cream and no sugar, and I've had hot chocolate instead of coffee. I mean, it's easy to pass judgment on other people. It's easy to condemn. It's easy to want to kind of crawl through the window and tell them why what they're doing is wrong. And so I make all kinds of rash decisions because of the COVID thing and what's going on around me. And I wonder how many times in that we're fighting God, when maybe it's just like the male said, that God is in it. And maybe God's in that frustration, and he's in that waiting, and he's in that time that we're being frustrated, or in that day-to-day living situation that you're in right now that you would just love to get out of. And I don't know. It doesn't come across that Peter and John were like that in their situation, that they wanted to get out of. I mean, I'm sure if you just said, like, door number one, two, or three, and three is get out, and there was a choice, and that we didn't have to do anything wrong or deny Jesus, and, you know, I mean, none of us would want to be in that position of being under judgment by others, by the authorities. None of us would want to go to jail. None of us would want to be flogged. None of us would want to be hauled in front of the Supreme Court justices of the day. But it doesn't seem like they're in a real big hurry to exit the suffering. I wonder how many times the things that we are actually frustrated about are actually something that God sent our way for a benefit. God's allowed to come our way for a benefit. We just don't see it. We just don't recognize it. And Gamaliel's words are very convicting. And I wonder how many times I've unknowingly been wrestling with God. We need to be careful as a church when it comes to condemning. I guess what really is getting me is some of the things I've seen in the last week on Facebook, condemning other ministries, condemning other pastors, condemning other congregations around North America. Some of the words that are said about people who maybe don't see things the exact same way we do. They love Jesus. They believe in the fundamentals of the faith, virgin birth, the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, substitutional atonement. I mean, all those things. I mean, it would be like a Pharisee. It'd be just ringing the bell all the time. And yet maybe we don't agree with how they do things. And maybe sometimes we assign motive, which Jesus really gets on people's case when you assign motives. But what I've seen on Facebook this week has just been like, it's been vicious. And those are our brothers and sisters. And just think, if it was your family member and somebody was treating them like that, well, they are our family member in the Lord. And that's where grace and no, we may not see things like they do. We may not do what they would do, but we can be kind. We can be gracious. We can agree to disagree on some things. And we certainly shouldn't be condemning them. As a church, we need to be careful about how we speak about those who govern us. I think Gamaliel's counsel is good there. I mean, Romans says that they're there as a sword of justice, to do what's right. Now, do they always do what's right? I understand why why you get frustrated with the government, and I get frustrated with the government, and but it's easy to condemn them. It's easy to go after our leaders when we're not the ones having to make those hard decisions. And so I would say to you that there needs to be a lot of grace there. So be careful what you say. Be careful before you go after our Prime Minister. Be careful before you go after a member of the House of Commons. Be careful how you go after our provincial leadership and our municipal leadership. Because we too might be fighting the very hand of God. Well, finally, as a church, we need to know that there are times where actual obedience can be costly. And the disciples today, they found themselves there. This time they don't just get a jail sentence. This time they don't just get hauled in front of the magistrates. This time they are flogged. Physical pain has a way of getting our attention. Physical pain has a way of making us change our minds. Physical pain has a way of affecting us like nothing else. They come into real persecution. Not imagined persecution, not persecution because they're being knobs. Persecution because they were doing exactly what God told them to do, how he told them to do it, when he told them to do it, and they take that consequence and they run with it, and they are happy to take the punishment in order to walk in obedience. Man, I don't know. That one seems really difficult. And we don't know how much longer before that kind of thing may reach us here. I mean, I know our brothers and sisters around the world, there are many who face that daily. And they count it worthy to be deemed able to stand against that kind of opposition. Well, Father, we would ask today that you would prepare our hearts that if in our lifetime, if in our day, that we have to face opposition, we would be ready. I pray that in this day and in this time, that if we are called upon to do what's right and to suffer persecution in the public forum, condemnation in the public court of opinion, that we would stand ready and sure and able to do what's right and to do it happily, because we're being obedient to you. I pray for us as a church that we would not be like the Sanhedrin, that we would follow the counsel of Gamaliel, to be careful who we speak against, to be careful who we criticize. For those very people may be used by you in our lives and in our churches and in our country and in our city and our province to actually accomplish something that you are willing and desiring to accomplish, and they are the tool in your hand. So help us to be wise in those things. And today we would ask that you would prepare us. Prepare us for the days ahead. Prepare us as we come out of this COVID thing. Prepare us as if there's more time to be spent in isolation, that we would not take up some of these causes. Be careful about ranting and railing against fellow brothers and sisters. That we would not have that kind of heart, but that our heart would be open to you, kind, compassionate. That we would proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news that Jesus has come. He is your son, and he has made a way for us to find forgiveness in your court, the highest court. And so we come to you today. Teach us, I pray, be with us. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Be sure to tune in to the Zoom at 11:30 as we ask Dusty and Nathan questions. And remember, have a great week and live for Him.
So as we close, just with the thought in mind that if God is for us, who can be against us? If God is in it, then you know it will succeed. And what a powerful reminder that we've just heard. And I think this is a great song to close with. The Lion and the Lamb. Here we go.
One, two.
The Lion of Judah.
every knee will bow, every tongue confess that he is Lord. We are looking forward to seeing you at 11:30 for a question and answer time with us. Now remember, this is not Stump the Chump. This is just questions so that we can get to know each other a little bit. But we're looking forward to seeing you all there at 11:30 in the foyer. The Zoom meeting. God bless you. We'll see you there.